At about this time, Kinlach Pare called a meeting in the palace. And in that meeting, Fashteitzach, were his Eitzegebers, his advisors, his Kishefmachers, his magicians, his stargazers. Stargazers, Kinlach, were people that were able to look up in the stars and see what's going to happen in the future. And of course, Bilam was there too. And Pare got up, and he said to the people in the room,
"It's been a long time since we began to deal with the Jewish problem. But I am very frustrated. I thought that by now we will have them totally destroyed. We must come up with a way that we can totally destroy them, so there's nothing left of them. Nothing at all. And I've given this lots of thought, and this is what I've come up with. You know, there Hashem, when he punishes Midor Keneged Midor. We must outsmart him. Any suggestions from the crowd? How do we outsmart him?"
I think we should kill them, right. I said that a long time ago. I said kill them, right.
I know. I told you we need to eliminate them. But the question is how.
How we do this, right? How we do this? That's a hard question, right. I don't know the question, right. If I try to answer, right, I won't be right. So I will not answer the question, right. I be quiet, right.
Good. Maybe someone else has got a suggestion to make. First of all, I would like to congratulate you for your insight about Zer Hashem. Great and noble power. I would like to add just a little bit to what you're saying. We must find a way that Zer Hashem cannot take revenge and punish us. But also, we need to find a way that we can punish them and eliminate them. And let me explain. Their great-grandfather, Avram Avinu, was taken by King Nimrod and thrown into the fiery furnace in Ur Kasdim. He survived there. So it's not a good idea to try to kill them with the fire, because they can survive fire. And even if they don't survive fire, Zer Hashem can punish us with fire, like you said, noble King Paro. The sword is also an option when it comes to eliminating them. But if we look back into history, we find that their grandfather Yitzchok was under the knife at the Akedah, and the knife never cut him. So it doesn't work against them either. And even if it would work, Zer Hashem can use the sword against us. Yaakov Avinu compared all of his children to the stone. So we can't stone them. And even if we could, Zer Hashem could punish us with stones. My suggestion, your majesty, is to punish them with water. Water? Why do you say water? Why do I say water? Very simple. We never found that they survived water. And after Hashem brought the marble on the world, he promised he would never bring another marble. So how can he punish the whole Mitzrayim with water if he promised he's never going to bring the marble again?
Oh, I think so. He's saying such a good thing, Bilam. Oh, he's saying so good. Oh, right. Right, he's saying so good. Kill them with water. Oh, right. All right, very good. Kill them with water.
good suggestion. I would like to try something else before we do that. I'm a bit uncomfortable taking a group of people and trying to kill them outright. We have a very good reputation by our neighbors, and if people see that the Mitzrim went ahead and killed the entire Jewish nation, this won't bode well for us. They'll look down on us. I've got a plan.
And so Paroi set out with his evil plan. Now, Kindalach, you know that in Mitzrayim, the Eibishter benched the Yidden, that when a lady gave birth, she gave birth to 6 children in one shot. Shisha bekeres echod. So they needed a lot of help when they had a baby. So there were about 500 ladies in Mitzrayim, and they were called miyaldois, midwives. A midwife is somebody that helps a lady when she's having a baby. Now, in charge of these 500 miyaldois, there were 2 big tzidkonius. One tzadekis' name was Yocheved, and the other one was Yocheved's daughter, and her name was Miriam. So Paroi called in Yocheved and Miriam, and he said to them as follows.
I'm sure you know that there's a terrible problem in Goshen. Overcrowding, so many Yidden, and there's just not enough space for them. And therefore I've thought of a wonderful plan, and I'm calling on you to help me with it. I propose...
As it says in the Pasuk Vayoymer, and Paroi said, Bialetchem esoyiv riois. When you come to help the Yiddish ladies, or the Isem aloev noim in beinu, vahamiten oisoi. When you come to the Yiddish houses, and there are the 6 babies over there that were born, if there is a baby boy there, make sure that you kill him. Vimbast. But if it's a baby girl, v'choya, you can let her live. This was Paroi's evil plan, that the miyaldois, the Yiddish miyaldois, that came to help the ladies with their children, they should kill the children. And of course, Paroi said, you should make sure that they don't figure out that you are the one that killed the little baby. Make believe like it was some sort of accident and some sort of unfortunate event. The Pasuk tells us, Vatireno ha-miyaldois eso Elohim. But Kindalech, these tzidkonius were afraid of the Eibishter. And even though Paroi said that he would reward them for doing what he said, and if they didn't listen to them, he would punish them, they didn't listen to him. And they didn't listen to what Paroi said. And they allowed the children to be alive, and not just did they allow the children to live, but they took care of the children. And they fed them, and they cleaned them, and they made sure that they were healthy and well taken care of. And now when Paroi heard that the miyaldois aren't listening to what he said, so he right away called them. As it says in the Pasuk Vayoymer Lohen, and he said to the miyaldois, Madua asisen sadover hazeh? Why did you do this, Vatchayeno esayalodim, and you let the children live? And then the miyaldois told Paroi, what can we do? The Yiddish ladies are much different than the Goyish ladies. Yiddish ladies, before we even get there, they have their children. Ki choyos heina. They don't need us. They know how to take care of their kids without us. And because Kindalech, they didn't listen to Paroi, it says in the Pasuk, Vayehi kiyoru ha-miyaldois esu Elohim. And being that the miyaldois were afraid of the Eibishter more than they were afraid of Paroi, Vayas lohem botim. And the Eibishter made for them botim. And Chazal teach us that botim means Yocheved was Zoicha, that her children were the Kohanim and the Leviim, and Miriam was Zoicha, that her children would end up being the kings in Klal Yisrael. David HaMelech was an Einikel from Miriam. Now, Kindalach, after this episode with the Mialdois, one night Pari went to sleep. And when he fell asleep, he began to dream. And in his dream, an old man started coming towards him, and he was holding a vukshul. He was holding a scale. And on one side of the scale were all the people of Mitzrayim, all the Mitzrim. And on the other side of the scale was a little shepsela, a little lamb. And the lamb weighed more than all of the people in Mitzrayim. And then the old man took all the money from Mitzrayim. And he put all the money onto the side together with the Mitzrim. And still the little lamb weighed more. And then he took all the armaments, the tools of war, the swords, the spears, everything that the Mitzrisha army used to fight their wars, and he put them on the side of the Mitzrim, and still the little lamb weighed more. He woke up. He was terrified. And he sent a message that he has to have a private meeting with his three most trusted advisors, Bilam, Iyev, and Yisroi. And he sat down with them, and he said, "Listen to me, I've got no time to call everybody together to this particular meeting. I had a dream." And he told them the dream. "I have no idea what it means." "Your Majesty, if you'll excuse me, things are getting worse and worse. The Jewish problem must come to a final solution. We cannot wait around anymore. We must bring a final solution with them. I told you that there is problems with them. I suggest that at this point, we don't ask the Mialdois to kill all the Jewish little boys. We take them ourselves with our army, and we kill them ourselves with the water." "I tend to agree with you. I think the time has come. What do you think, Yisroi?" And Yisroi Kindalach was an Erelach person. And he knew what Pari was doing was the wrong thing. And he looked Pari straight in the eye. He said, "Great exalted Pari, I've been watching what was going on for a long time with the Yidden here in Mitzrayim, and I must tell you that I think what's going on is wrong. These Yidden did nothing wrong, and the people here hate them for no good reason. And now you want to kill them? It's wrong!"
"Oh, you don't like my policies, is that the case? We have a little bit of a disagreement on how to run a country. Is that the case, my dear friend Yisroi? Well, you're excused from the meeting, and I would like to see you in 2 hours. I would appreciate if you bring your family along."
Yisroi excused himself from the meeting, and he knew exactly why Pari wants to see him. And then Pari turned to Iyev, and he said to Iyev,
"Well, you're my third trusted advisor, Iyev. What do you think?"
And Iyev thought to himself, "Does it make a difference if I tell him not to kill the Yidden? He's not going to listen to me anyway. I'm going to keep quiet and say nothing." And he looked at Pari and he said, "King Pari, I don't know. I don't know what the right thing to do is." Now when Yisroi left the room, he ran through the hallways till he came downstairs, down in the bowels of the palace, where the king's treasure houses were. And he walked into one of the treasure rooms. There was something there that he needed. And he was running as fast as he could through the hallway. And finally got to the treasure room, and he walked into the treasure room. And there, amongst all the other treasures, was a stick, a staff. There was something very special about this staff. He grabbed the staff, and he ran. He got his family, jumped on their horses, and they fled from Mitzrayim. He knew Pari wanted to kill him. And now, Kindalach, Pari got together all his generals, and he spoke to them very clearly his instructions. He said to him as follows,
"Gentlemen, after much deliberation, we have come to the conclusion that we must solve the Jewish problem with the final solution. We want you to follow anytime you see a midwife, a mayaleres, going into a house. That means that there is a Jewish baby about to be born. You must follow her in, and if that baby is a boy, take that baby, bring him down to the Nilus, the river in Mitzrayim. Place him right next to the water. We don't want to throw him in with our bare hands. We can get punished by their Hashem for that. So let the water, the waves come up and take him into the water. And this way we'll rid the Jews of all their little baby boys. And if there are no baby boys being born, slowly, after a few years, there will be no Jews left.
And so, Kendalach, it began. The armies of Mitzrayim, special soldiers, came marching into Geishan. And in the middle of the night, they started banging on the doors.
Alles raus! Alles raus! Raus, raus, raus! Alles raus!
They came in and they saw a little baby boy. They hopped away the baby boy. And they started schlepping the baby boy and taking him down to the river. And the mother was screaming, "My baby! Give me back my baby! It's my baby!" They wouldn't listen to her and they chased her away. By the Nilus Kendalach, the babies were swallowed into the water. And soon it wasn't just the soldiers that were taking away the Yiddish kids, but all the Mitzrim joined in this baby hunt. And wherever you went in Goshen, there were Mitzrim looking around trying to find Yiddish boys to chop them away. And if they found one, they quickly called a soldier, a Mitzrish soldier. They said, "There's a little baby boy in that house. Go chop it away from them." And he came and he broke down the door.
Host! Host!
Take the baby and he'd run down to the Nilus. And pretty soon, Kendalach Pari got so caught up with this fun that he was having that he forgot all about not getting punished. And he would take the little babies and he told them to throw the baby right into the Nilus. Throw them into the river. Don't even leave them on the side. And it became a big game for all of the Mitzrim. And the Yidden didn't know what to do. It was terrible. Wherever you went, there were Yidden that were being schlepped away from their kids. And so the Yidden, in the middle of the night, dug tunnels underneath their houses. And that's where the mommies had the Kindlech. And the little baby boys were born. And that's where the little baby boys lived. But sooner than later, the Mitzrim started realizing something's wrong. And the Mitzri ladies would come into the Yiddish houses.
"You mean to tell me there are no Yiddish kids in this house? We will see."
And the Mitzrisha lady was holding with her one of her little babies, a little Shegetzel. And she would hold him upside down, and she would start to smack the little baby, and the baby would start screaming on the top of his lungs. And the minute that the Mitzrisha baby would start crying, the Yiddish baby that was underneath the house in the tunnel heard. And when one baby hears another baby crying, that baby starts to cry too. Aha!
There he is, somewhere underneath the floorboard! Quick, quick, I'll get a soldier!"
And the soldier would come and he'd chop away the little baby. And any time they found Yidden hiding their children, they would kill the parents too. And it was terrible. There was horrible terror all over Goshen. Yidden didn't know what to do. They were afraid of anything. They were afraid of their own shadows. And now, Kendalech, the ladies didn't know what to do. So they went into the woods, into the orchards where the apples and the oranges were growing. In the middle of the night, the Eibishter made that they should fall asleep. They fell asleep, and when they woke up, there were their babies. But unfortunately, Kendalech Nebuch, they had to leave the babies there, and they had to go home. Because they knew if the Mitzrim would see that they're missing, they'd come looking for them in the forest. But the Eibishter sent a Malach, and the Malach came, and it washed the babies and took care of the babies. And each baby got two rocks, one little stone. When they sucked it, milk came out, and the other little stone, when they sucked it, honey came out. And these little Kindlech grew up, and when they were old enough, they walked back to Goshen. And it was a nest. They were able to recognize their parents. And they all came back to their parents after many years when they had grown up. Soon the mitzvah noticed. What is this? There's a lot of eating, especially ladies. As a matter of fact, only ladies that are going up into the forest. What's going on? And they started to become suspicious. And so one of the mitzvah generals, one of the soldiers, got together a group of mitzvah soldiers.
Let's go, we'll go up into the forest. I bet they're hiding their kids up there.
They come riding up to the clearing. And when they're getting closer, oy vey, what's gonna be? They're gonna find the little babies laying in the woods and they'll kill all of them. And they're coming closer and closer. And all of a sudden, the Amish, they made a nest. And the ground opened up its mouth and swallowed the little babies. The mitzvah soldiers are riding around looking. Something is funny here. I'll bet they're under the ground somewhere. Stick your swords into the ground. They stuck their swords into the ground, but the Abishter made sure that the kindlech were deep down enough that the swords didn't touch them. And the minute the mitzvah left, kids came back out of the ground. And Kindlech, you need to know something very important too. That of all the babies that were thrown into the Nile, 600,000 babies. A malach came and caught them and took them to a faraway place in the desert. And they also got the milk and the honey, and the malach took care of them. So even though the goyim did such terrible thing to the Eden, you should know that these children were saved by the Rebbeinu Shel Olam. Now, Kindalach, after this time, Paroi was sitting in his throne room, and in came his leading stargazer. And the stargazer looked at Paroi and he said,
"Exalted Paroi, I have some bad news to bring to you."
"What's the bad news?"
"Well, I was gazing at the stars with my colleagues, and we saw something very strange. Up until now, we have been reading in the stars that a boy will be born that will take the Jews out of Egypt. We thought up until now that it will be a Jewish boy. But the stars are unclear at this point. It seems like he might even be an Egyptian boy. I don't know."
"An Egyptian boy, you would say, to save the Jews? Why would he do a thing like that? That sounds ridiculous."
"Your Majesty, I can't tell you, but it's very unclear. It's kind of cloudy."
"Well, if there's any chance that it is an Egyptian boy, let the word go out that even the Egyptian boys should be killed."
And so Kindalach, Paroi in his hate for the Eden, killed even the Mitzrisha baby. And now Kindalach, in middle of this dark, dreadful time, when the Mitzrim were hunting the Yiddish Kindalach and schlepping them away from their parents and throwing them into the river, during this time is when the ray of sunlight was being born. As it says in the Pasuk, "Vayelech ish mi beis Levi, vayikach es bas Levi." In Mitzrayim at this time there lived a great tzaddik. This tzaddik was the Roish of the Sanhedrin. He was the head of the Sanhedrin. He was a Novi. This great tzaddik Kindlech never did Naveira his entire life. And this great tzaddik was a grandson of Levi. His name was Amram. His father's name was Kohos. And his grandfather was Levi. And he was one of the Gedolei Hador at that time. And when he saw what Paroi was doing, and he saw Yiddish Kindlech being thrown into the river, Amram made a decision, and he let everybody know about it, that he will no longer be married to his wife Yocheved. He was married to the Mayaledes Yocheved, and now everybody saw that he's no longer married to his wife, so they all left their wives, and everybody wasn't married to their wife. So now no children will be born and no children can be killed. But Kindalach Amram had a daughter, and this daughter was only 3 years old. But she was a very special person, and she was a Nevi'ah. And she came over to her father, Fashteitzach Kindalach, with great derech eretz. And she said to her father, Tata Laban, if I may, I would like to suggest something. What you're doing by not being married is in a way worse than what Paroi is doing. Paroi is a gezeira against the zechorim, against the boys. But the nekevis, the girls can live. Paroi made a gezeira that a boy that is born should be thrown into the river. But that boy lived for 1 minute. And if he lived on this world for 1 minute, his neshama could go to Gan Eden. But you're not allowing that neshama to even come down for 1 minute, so it can't go to Gan Eden. And another thing, Paroi, it's not definite if you will kill every single one of the children. Maybe one of the parents will be successful in hiding that child. And the last thing, Tata Laban, I had a nevuah. And in the nevuah I saw that you and your wife are going to have a child that will save the Eden and take them out of Mitzrayim. And Amram listened to his daughter, Kindalech the god Lador, the father of this three-year-old girl. At Tzaddik, a wise man stopped and he listened to his three-year-old daughter. What do we see from here? We see godless. And he listened to her, not just did he listen to her. He did what she said. He took her mussar seriously. And he sent out invitations, and they made a big tumult, and they made a giant chasaneh, and all of Goshen was invited. Because he wanted everybody to know that he's getting married again. And when he got married again, everybody saw Amram's getting married again. So Gans Klal Yisrael married their wives again. And when they got married, the Mitzrim were watching. Aha! It takes 9 months for a baby to be born. That means 9 months after Amram got married, we can expect him to have a baby. So they watched very closely and they counted. But Kindalech the Eibishter made that the baby was born only after 6 months. And Yocheved, when she was gonna have the baby, went down into the basement. She didn't want anybody to see that there was a baby in the house. And when the baby was born, Kindalach, the entire house filled up with light. As it says in the Pasuk, Vatele oisoi ki toivu. And she was able to see that he's very good. He was lichtik, there was a kedusha around him. The lichtikate, the light was the oir agonuz. The light that Hashem hid, Kindalach, during Sheshes Yimei Bereshis. The world was full of a very, very strong light, and the Eibishter took that light and he hid it in the Torah. This little boy had that light around him. And it was very strange because when the boy was born, usually Kindalech, when they're born, they cry. The boy didn't cry. And they took a closer look. They saw he had a bris. Something special about this boy. And Amram turned around to his daughter Miriam and he kissed her and he said, I see you were right, my daughter. And for the next 3 months, Kindalach, they watched the little boy and they took care of him with great care. There was something very special about him, but as the 3 months was coming to a close, the Mitzrim started swarming everywhere around the house. And it was very obvious they were waiting for the 9 months, and then they would come breaking down the door and schlepping out the baby. So in middle of the night, as all of Goshen tried to sleep, Yocheved put together a little basket. And the basket was made out of reeds. Reeds are a type of plant that grow in the river. She took those reeds and made a basket out of them and then smeared the outside of the basket with tar, pech. It's like the black material that they make roads out of. And the inside she smeared with lehm,
lime. She didn't want that this heilige baby should smell the bad smell of the tar.
And then in the stillkeit van de nacht, she snuck down out of her house. Now down to the river, she took the little basket.
Can imagine Kendall, she was crying as she took this heilige little baby. And she set him afloat into the river. And she snuck back to her house.
And Yoichevet put him into the Nilus for a very important reason. Because she knew what the stargazers were telling Paroi. That the leader of the Eden that's going to be born is going to be punished through water. That's why they were chopping every Yiddish baby just in case it's the leader, and they were throwing him into the water because that's how he was supposed to be punished according to the stars. So she took the little baby and put him in the water with the hope that now when the Sternenseher, when the stargazers look up, they will see, up, this baby that's going to save the Eden is in the water. We have nothing to worry about. And Kindle Chitaka helped. They came into Paroi and said, the baby's in the water. We have nothing to worry about. We succeeded.